Morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 24th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies for absence have been received from David Stewart and Siobhan McMahon. Our only agenda item today is to take oral evidence in advance of publication of the Scottish Government's draft budget 2016-17. The committee has agreed to use this year's budget scrutiny as an opportunity to focus further on identifying what further action is necessary within its remit to help meet the climate change targets. Although the draft budget is not expected to be published until the 16th of December, this session will provide an opportunity for witnesses to comment on the outcomes of the current year's spending and to suggest what more might need to be done both in this financial year and beyond to meet the targets. This session will also help inform questions for the committee's second and final evidence session on the 6th of January with the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities. Can I welcome Professor Jan Bebbington, a Professor of Accounting and Sustainable Development at the University of St Andrews, Teresa Bray, Chief Executive of Changeworks, representing the existing Homes Alliance Scotland, Dr Sam Gardner, Head of Policy at WWF Scotland, John Lauder, a regular attender at our committee sessions, who is the National Director at SUSTRANS, and last but not least, Sara, Thiam, Director of the Institute of Civil Engineers Scotland, representing the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force. And firstly, can I ask or invite witnesses to make any short introductory remarks? Would you like to kick off, Professor Bebbington?
Thank you, Convener. Today I'm focusing on a carbon accounting methodology which really highlights the need to take a whole system approach when you're deciding if something is low carbon. I'm not commenting on the infrastructure itself. Many other witnesses on this panel are much better qualified than I am to do that. I'd also like to highlight that in making the observation, I'm drawing on a Scottish Funding Council study of the University of St Andrews, where we're putting together a bioheat plant, and partly of trying to proof that investment and understanding what we are doing. We've invested in some research alongside that. I'm drawing extensively on expertise from the University of Edinburgh as well in their carbon accounting unit. And the key observation that I'll be making, and you'll be happy to be asked more about, is that if we're going to go for low carbon infrastructure, it's a whole system approach. It isn't a bit by bit approach, but it's actually how the whole system morphs and changes together. And then the second key observation is that there's a great deal of uncertainty in that planning process, but there are methodologies that are starting to emerge that help to inform that uncertainty.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Bray.
I welcome the opportunity to speak to you today on behalf of the Existing Homes Alliance. We're pleased that the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee recognises the importance of energy efficiency of existing homes. Energy efficiency is a key activity in tackling climate change, but also has much wider social and economic benefit. The Scottish Government has made the commitment to energy efficiency by making it a national infrastructure priority. It's important that this is followed through with financial commitments too and has the level of ambition to make a real difference in terms of both reducing carbon emissions but also in tackling fuel poverty, targets for both of which have been missed in recent years. The National Infrastructure Priority should have the objective of all homes reaching EPC C or higher by 2025, which the government needs to commit to. This is ambitious, with 61%, 1.4 million of our homes need to be improved. The Alliance estimates that £140 million per year for the next 10 years will be required. It's important the Scottish Government makes its own evaluation of the funding required. We recognise that this is, with the funding constraints, £140 million in the coming year will not be available, but there should be seen as a transitional year leading to greater years of funding. Not all this funding will be coming from Scottish Government grants. Homeowners should be required to make a contribution where they can afford to do so. There would be challenges in spending such large amounts of money in the short term, and delivery plans need to be developed and the supply chain as well. There is, though, established programmes of delivery in the area-based schemes already funded by the Scottish Government and the Warmer Home Scotland. We want to ensure that this momentum's continued to actually tackle the issue of our poor quality homes. For the coming year, we wish to see that the current budget is maintained, but also recognise that the funding coming from the energy company obligation will be falling, so to maintain the level of activity, there will need to be extra resources committed. The Scottish Government is making difficult decisions with regard to the comprehensive spending review. Spending on energy efficiency has so many benefits with regard to climate change and fuel poverty, householder finance, jobs and health, and there has to be the financial support.
Thank you. Dr. Gardner.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. Every year since the passage of the Climate Change Act, WWF has submitted evidence to the Parliament during its scrutiny of the finance budget. Each year we have asked, is the budget aligned with the requirements of the Act? And each year our assessment has failed to reassure us that the budget fulfils the expectations set by this climate legislation. If this year is to be any different, as a minimum, the draft budget will need to do the following things. You'll need to, firstly, set out in a clear and transparent way the proposed expenditure alongside the policies in the RPP, the report and proposals and policies, so as to give confidence to all stakeholders that the budget fulfils the commitment of the Cabinet to embed climate change in the autumn budget process. This has never happened in the past and has always meant that committees such as yours are frustrated in their efforts to establish the extent to which the budget is aligned with the Climate Change Act. Funding for energy efficiency, the second point, should reflect the commitment to designate it as a national infrastructure priority, and in particular provide a clear goal of ensuring all homes reach an EPC of C by 2025. As we approach the 2016 deadline, 1 million homes remain trapped in fuel poverty. That's 39% of Scotland's households. Since 1990, emissions from the housing sector have fallen by less than 13%, and emissions fluctuate widely from year to year. A sufficiently funded national retrofit programme for Scotland's homes could generate nearly 10,000 jobs, save households up to £500 a year, could save the NHS between £48 to £80 million per year, and reduce dependence and costs on fuel imports. The third final point clearly signals a significant shift in focus of the capital budget towards low-carbon infrastructure. The infrastructure decisions we make in the next few years will determine how we live in 2050. The future will be decided in the next decade, and it must be consistent with supporting low-carbon technologies and behaviours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Lauder.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for inviting SUSTRANS to come along. I'll be covering active travel, which covers walking and cycling, key elements in reducing carbon emissions, particularly in the urban context, and in particular at allowing Scots to choose to not use cars for every trip that they make. The vast majority of car trips remain very short and very repetitive. That hasn't changed in a number of years and isn't helping transport to reduce its carbon emissions. So from that point of view, I'm also pleased to come along today because there are good positive signs of growth in certain areas in Scotland, and where leadership is being shown by local authorities and by Transport Scotland, there are some positive signs that we're beginning to see more people opting to cycle and a continuing good number of people continuing to walk for everyday short trips. So that's very positive, and I'll be covering that in my evidence as well. However, I think that what I will also be concluding is that the funding which has been increased for active travelling is at a very vulnerable stage. It needs to be kept at the level and grown over the next few years if we're really to realise the ambition, very good ambition, of the Scottish Government to grow the numbers of people walking and grow the numbers of people significantly by cycling for short trips.
Thank you. And finally, Ms. Thiam.
Convener, thank you for inviting us to share the work of the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force. The task force brings together key figures from the infrastructure life cycle across public, private and academic sectors with expertise in construction and in finance. The outputs from the Scotland's Way Ahead project, which is led by the task force, include the case for low carbon infrastructure, a long list of 10 low carbon project examples which could help drive the required step change in coming years. The final output will be a short list of 2 to 3 projects. The research that's been undertaken on behalf of the task force highlights the benefits for Scotland in investing in low carbon infrastructure. In addition to meeting climate change targets, low-carbon infrastructure has the potential to deliver considerable economic and social benefits. Failure to invest in this type of low-carbon infrastructure will lock us into high emissions and vulnerability to the multiple impacts of climate change, leaving a legacy of buildings, roads, transport infrastructure, energy generation and more, which will be expensive to adapt in the future. the shortlist of low-carbon projects which will emerge from our work, we believe are worthy of consideration and inclusion in Scotland's future infrastructure investment plans. We also believe that the Scottish Government has a unique role to play, both in directing infrastructure priorities and as an investor. The case for low-carbon infrastructure that's been commissioned by the task force showed that around half of the current infrastructure investment in Scotland could be described as low-carbon. However, international comparators suggest that a significant increase will be required to enable delivery of the ambitious targets that we have in Scotland. The Scottish Government's next spending review provides an opportunity to shift capital spending towards low-carbon projects, and the Scottish Budget 2016-17 is a good starting point for this transition. The Scottish Government's commitment to making improvement of building energy efficiency a national infrastructure priority has significant potential to deliver on social justice and economic benefits. So in summary, the evidence I'm giving today, we believe progress has been made in reducing carbon emissions, provides a good foundation on which to build. However, a step change in pace and scale is required.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Thiam, and thank you to all the other witnesses. Can I perhaps kick off just by asking about the ambitious climate change targets? The Scottish Government has acknowledged that meeting the targets set by the Parliament has been challenging. I just wonder if you have any insight into what difference changing the baseline has made to meeting that target. Dr. Gardner, do you want to kick off?
Yes, I can certainly have a stab at it. It's certainly true that every year that the greenhouse gas inventory is revised as a result of improved understanding of where our emissions come from, and as a consequence, our understanding of our emissions in what they were in 1990 is different from what it was when the Climate Change Act was passed. And that makes the emissions reduction required in order to hit those annual targets harder than it was envisaged when we first set the Climate Change Act. That's not to say that we couldn't have actually hit the target last year had it not been, if we'd actually seen greater policy effort. We only missed it by a small fraction. If we'd seen effort in other sectors, particularly transport, where at the moment there's only one policy in the RPP that's targeted at reducing emissions from the transport sector, we could have hit those targets. So to say that we've missed the target simply as a result of the greenhouse gas inventory revisions is incorrect. It certainly had an impact, but so would greater policy effort have had an impact to negate that.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay, just sticking with that for the moment, The Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, Aileen MacLeod, has stated, and I quote, "It will take time to produce a credible package of proposals and policies to make up the shortfall from previous annual targets, which total 17.5 million tonnes of CO2 equivalent." So do you agree with that statement, or do you see that as being in opposition to what you've just said about...
I agree it will take time. How much time it needs to take is, I think, the area of discussion. So we've missed four targets, and as I understand it, the Section 36 report that's required by the Climate Change Act to say what steps the Scottish Government will take in order to compensate for those emissions hasn't been produced. In the first instance, that was captured by the first RPP. We're now in a situation where the next RPP, the third one, isn't likely to be out until the very end of next year and may indeed, given how long it will take, run into 2017. And we're waiting for that in order to compensate for emissions reductions that were excessive in 2013. So there is a need for greater urgency in how we address our overshoot in emissions. And the fact that we have 17.5 million tonnes of excess emissions have been generated means it's going to be an increasingly hard challenge to get that under control unless we see concerted policy efforts, which the Minister has committed to, that they will bring forward new policies. And, you know, it's certainly WWF's hope that we see those in the very immediate future. And this budget is an opportunity to kind of reflect greater emphasis in certain areas like energy efficiency and transport.
OK, fine. And perhaps the other witnesses could address the concerted policy effort that you believe is required to make further progress. Where do you wish the government to place that effort?
Certainly, I feel there's opportunities for energy efficiency. We do not require huge technological changes to make this happen. We've already got existing programmes that could be ramped up relatively easily. It is difficult because you're covering so many homes, but it's proven to make reductions already in carbon reduction. I think there will be the need to support behaviour change linked to the physical measures so that people take advantage of the improved efficiency. But there's certainly opportunity within the housing sector, which will make a much greater difference to people's lives as well as meeting the climate change targets.
Okay. Mr. Lauder.
In terms of the transport sector, I think there are already good policies available. And in terms of putting them together into a package, I don't think that that's happening with enough emphasis and enough drive, particularly from the transport sector. So we still have an ambitious programme of road construction. But in addition to that, we don't give, I think, sufficient emphasis. I don't get the sense from transport that there is a real drive to reduce emissions, particularly through vehicle emissions, and yet I think the policies are there. I don't think we're pushing them quite as hard as we should be.
Okay, thank you. Do you have anything to add, Professor Bebbington?
Could I just point to the heat sector in particular as an area that's needing of far greater attention? So the committee will be familiar with the fact that heat makes up over 50% of our energy demand and about 50% of our emissions. And yet currently we're just at about less than 4% of that being met by renewable sources and 1% of our heat demand being met through community or district heating networks. If we are to decarbonise our heat, as the Climate Change Act requires us to, and make significant progress by 2030, it's an area that's going to need ever greater concerted action. And district heating is an opportunity for the Scottish Government to align its capital budget with investment that will help create jobs, tackle fuel poverty, and also drive down emissions. So we would hope that in future budgets, including this one, there's a signal of greater support for district heating in particular. And the District Heating Loan Fund, which has been it's been very competitive and it's been well used, there's a need for that to be continued. And there's also a need for the Scottish Government to explore how it can underwrite or mitigate the risks associated with the oversizing of district heating pipe work so as to allow for networks to be expanded. It's the type of infrastructure where there's a long return but a high upfront cost, and where you've seen that development take place across Scandinavia and Northern Europe, it's always been in the first instance facilitated by the state in some way, getting that return over time.
Okay, did you want to come in, Ms. Thiam?
To add to that three of the 10 projects that the low carbon infrastructure, the long list of low carbon infrastructure projects, are actually around district heating, and a fourth around energy efficiency retrofit. And we've actually been having the 10 projects, we've been through a peer review process just earlier this week, and it's becoming increasingly apparent what some of the regulatory, contractual and sort of ownership issues are coming into play there that could be addressed, some of the barriers that could be removed there.
Thank you. Mike McKenzie would like to come in.
Thank you. My question, I suppose, is principally for Dr. Gardner, because I recall a few months ago, and I'm sure you will too, that you did an analysis suggesting that it would be entirely possible to have all power generation in Scotland from renewable sources by 2030. And you were looking for MSPs to sign, endorse that analysis. And I found myself very keen to do it. I had my quill pen sharpened. I had my bottle of ink. I had my blotting paper. And my pen was hovering over the paper. And then I thought, no, I can't sign this. I wanted to sign it, but I couldn't sign it. And the reason I couldn't sign it is that Scottish Government has almost no powers over energy. And I realised that if only the UK Government would do the right thing, we could easily do this. And it occurs to me, from what you've said this morning, that there is a real problem, in as much as a significant amount of the power required to make a lot of the... To ensure that we go down this lower carbon route doesn't reside in this place, it resides in Westminster. You mentioned District Heating Loan Fund, but you'll know that in the projects out there, that on the ground, that they require complementary funding. So these projects are put together requiring eco funding, requiring Green Deal funding, and the District Heating Loan Fund. And that it's incredibly difficult sometimes to get them to stack up without all this complementary funding from each government playing its part. So my question really is, to what extent are we impeded by the actions of the UK government in trying to take forward the aims that you've all outlined this morning?
To what extent? I think it's clearly there is an impact of changes made at UK government level on energy policy. We've seen those over the summer, which have had a real impact on the deployment of onshore wind and solar. So it would be completely wrong to dismiss those as having no consequence on Scotland's ability to kind of pursue the low carbon agenda. But equally, it's not to say that those should prevent us from continuing to strive to fulfil that ambition. And I see concerted efforts in various parts of the Scottish Government's kind of agenda to do that. But to point to the changes being made at Westminster and then say, as a consequence, we can't do all that we can in order to hit those targets would be wrong. So there are certain areas that the Scottish Government should and continue to make strides to secure the low-carbon agenda. Regulation is one. So the Scottish Government has convened a subgroup to work on regulation for district heating in order to facilitate the growth of an industry that is struggling to make any headway because it currently doesn't have the confidence that there is going to be a market for it to deploy to, and the consumer doesn't have the protection that it would need. So there's steps that it could take in that regard to support the investment in district heating. On the power sector, for instance, where the Scottish Government has used the powers that it's got very well in order to support low carbon technologies, it should continue to do so. There is a certain inevitability to the 2030 scenario that WWF's commissioned from Gardasam, which suggested that we would have an entirely renewable power sector by then. What we're looking for is political parties to align themselves with that scenario so that we reap the benefits of aligning our kind of our policy strategically with the direction of travel that's happening in Scotland. So there are benefits to be enjoyed from doing that. I think on the energy efficiency side, we have the opportunity through the capital budget to better align that in order to deliver on energy efficiency. We've heard from Teresa, and you'll be familiar already of the very, very broad support that greater efforts on energy efficiency have across Civic Scotland. So over 50 organisations from Barnardos to Shelter to Age Concern all signed that commitment to suggest to ask the Scottish Government to support an emissions performance certificate rating of C by 2025 and the funding that's required in order to get there. So yes, there are consequences to UK government policy changes and they can be significant, but they don't come at the expense of Scottish Government being able to do all it can to fulfil its potential.
Anyone else on that?
Certainly there are a number of measures where it is made more difficult without the areas being flawed, but one of the things the Scottish Government has been good at doing is ensuring that we are able to access a greater proportion of things like the energy company obligation. If we look at solid walls, which are insulation, which has been very much supported by the Scottish Government under the area-based schemes, under the figures which for the most recent obligation, which started in April this year, 27% of the solid wall insulation measures have been installed in Scotland overall compared to the rest of the UK. Similar figures for renewable heat incentive, a greater proportion of the measures installed are based in Scotland, partly because we've got more rural properties, but also because of the support the Scottish Government provides in providing information and advice, whether it's through Resource Efficient Scotland or through Home Energy Scotland. It does make a difference how much money we can access and something like that is not directly under control.
Can I ask you about the submission from the Existing Homes Alliance Scotland? You say in that 2016-17 is a transitional year and the budget should be sufficient to allow for current programmes to continue, to compensate for cuts in UK programmes and piloting new programmes on behaviour change and loans. When you say that there is sufficient budget to compensate for cuts in UK programmes, do you have a figure?
One of the difficulties is with the energy company obligation, there's never any figures associated with that. You only get from the energy companies what the number of measures are. But we already know that for solid wall insulation, they've committed 80% of their two-year allocation that's already been committed, so there is going to be far less energy company obligation coming through. Initially, we were seeing rates of sort of £90 per tonne for energy company obligation. That's come down much closer to 30 in some areas and even down as low as 15. So the amount of money, the rate is going to come down and availability is becoming much more difficult with a number of the smaller installers operating out with the central belt can just not access energy company obligation at all, which is having an impact on the programmes there.
What is the level of the shortfall that you're asking the Scottish Government to make up then?
We were looking at, when we initially, the programme was announced, it was going to be £200 million with the funding produced by the Scottish Government. This current year was £103 million. So it is coming down. If you were looking at the £200 million, that is an additional £97 million. If you look to see what level of eco has been levered in to Scotland, it's probably looking about, I would have thought, down from that maximum of 90 is probably about half that rate, about 50 million, and I would expect that to fall even further in this coming year.
So the total figure would be what?
Total figure for to maintain the level of overall spending that was set is approximately 200 million.
Right, and the shortfall?
The shortfall as a result of ECO is about 70 million.
Right, okay, that's helpful. I think from what we've heard so far, if I've understood our witnesses correctly, they believe that there needs to be a realignment of spending from current priorities towards those investments that will have the biggest impact on reducing our climate change emissions. If I can ask Mr. Lauder about active travel, SUSTRANS in their submission have said that they believe that the government should commit 10% of the transport budget to active travel. Now, that's a significant increase on what the government currently allocates, notwithstanding the fact that we're at a record level of investment in active travel. Is there not a responsibility on the part of your organisation and other cycling organisations to say where that investment should come from? You know, are there specific transport projects to which the government is committed that can be postponed or where the level of investment can be reduced in order to release the funding that you would like to see?
I think that the call for 10% is a long-standing one. It comes from the Association of Directors of Public Health. And I think what we're looking at here is that the model in Scotland is the model that's been set by Edinburgh City Council, who have increased their budget year on year in a gradual way and grown it now to 8% of the transport budget being spent on cycling. And as a result of that, they have 12% of trips to work are now by bicycle, which is four times the national average. So I think it's a gradual process from within Transport Scotland, and I don't necessarily see that projects need to be postponed. I do think that there will be projects that the figure does need leadership, and it does need leadership from Transport Scotland. And I think the obvious budget there is from within the spend on the trunk road budget being moved, as you've said, being switched to this, to active travel, which is a new element that I think Transport Scotland need to do more about. I mean, currently, of the Transport Scotland budget, 2%, as you've said, goes on active travel, and of the staff within Transport Scotland, there are about 3 looking after walking and cycling. I think that's, in a sense, that 2% spend for what is returned is actually quite a reasonable return on investment when you consider the health benefits and the other benefits that come from more people opting to walk and cycle. And I think putting that gradual budget and that gradual growth together will begin to change how we see transport, because I think we've seen walking and cycling as a kind of nice thing to do on a summer's day, where in reality other small northern European countries have seen it as a legitimate part of the transport orthodoxy. And that's where walking and cycling need to move to. And with that level of leadership, then the local authorities will react and will follow, and they already do. So local authorities already outbid the funds that SUSTRANS are given by Transport Scotland to manage. So I don't think it is about necessarily cancelling entire schemes. I think it is about realigning budgets.
So how are you going to find the money within the trunk road budget then? Because that's the area that you've identified where the savings could be made.
Well, then,
can you say a bit more about where within the trunk road budget you'd be able to find given that you're saying that you wouldn't need to postpone or cancel existing projects, how would you be able to release funding from the trunk road budget to bring about the reallocation of funds to active travel?
Well, I think in not having access to the Transport Scotland budget and not having access to the people who set that budget to have that conversation, my mind would be like anyone else. I would be looking to see where savings could be made and reallocations could be made to gradually raise that. And to answer your question, Mr. Johnson, it would be the capital infrastructure spend that I would be looking at.
Okay. Claire.
Good morning. Just to turn things a wee bit on their head, do the panel consider that there are any areas of planned infrastructure expenditure that are likely to increase rather than reduce the carbon emissions?
I'll have a very initial stab. It's to point to the Strategic Transport Projects Review and the carbon assessment of that, which the Scottish Government publish on an annual basis. And that shows that the collective impact of those projects will result in an increase in emissions. That's projects across the board. That's from the Borders Railway, so this is looking to the past, to include Julian the A9, the Aberdeen Western Peripheral, the improvements to the rail network between Edinburgh and Glasgow. All of those things taken in the round will result in a collective increase in greenhouse gas emissions.
Anyone else?
I don't know if I could add any more to that.
Just in terms of that, obviously, having been round the Hodigan roundabout in Aberdeen on many occasions, been stuck in traffic there, is there not an expectation that some of the other problems will be reduced by the peripheral road, or has that been balanced out in the calculations that have been done by the government?
All the evidence throughout the world is that where you build more roads, you will get more emissions and more transport. Mm-hmm. I think what we haven't necessarily tackled much in Scotland at all is, as we've mentioned many times in this committee, that the vast bulk of car trips are short. Mm-hmm. 3 kilometres is the average, and that's across Scotland. So even in the most remote and rural areas, the bulk of trips that are made are very short and repetitive. So I think the question in that sense is not so much for the movement of goods and services by the trunk road network. How can we give people a better option not to have to use a car, notwithstanding that 1/3 of Scots don't have access to a car? So how do we give people better information but also much better facilities to be able to cycle or walk and thus reduce emissions in that way? Do we have an analysis of the nature of those trips that are log jamming the Hodigan roundabout of the morning? Do we know how many of those people are making a very... I'm not being critical of those people. That's their right to make that journey. But do we really have an analysis of how much that roundabout is being log jammed by people making a short trip that could be cycled or made by public transport, but they are making it by car because that's the best option that they've got?
Yep.
Refer back to the report on proposals and policies and the indication that it offers for what role the transport sector has to play. So there's an almost 300% increase in the annual emissions reductions required between 2014 and 2017 from the transport sector, according to the report on proposals and policies. So something has to change. There has to be a signal either through infrastructure, which will bring a return later in time, or through policy or through investment in supporting greater active travel. But a 300% increase in the reductions from the transport sector is required by the action plan the government set from the transport sector. And at the moment, there's just the one policy within the transport sector, within the RPP.
If I could also ask, it was mentioned about the use and the challenges in the renewable energy sector. It was announced in July of this year that the Scottish Government's Local Energy Challenge Fund will support 23 projects across Scotland, sharing £500,000 between them. The fund is for demonstrator projects designed to encourage the use and local ownership of renewable energy. Has anyone got any comment of how that might inform the decision-making going forward?
The Energy Challenge Fund is looking to solve some of those problems, whether it's to do with intermittency on renewables or the need for good connections, and particularly in remote areas where you've got extra capacity. So There are a lot of innovative approaches being adopted in whether it's demand reduction, in energy storage, in producing a systems approach to it. I think Scotland is taking the lead in that because we don't have the controls on our other levers. And I think that may well be some of the, if we look to the future, those challenge projects are very important. Only a small number of those will go through to completion. There are issues about the scale of funding, the timescales associated with it, because we are adopting new technologies, new approaches. Some of them will fail, and actually being prepared to take that risk to invest in projects that will fail is very important, because otherwise you won't make that step change in delivery. So it is producing that innovation. I think it's leading to innovation often on a community scale because we can't control things on a national scale. But that may well be the solution for energy systems if we look into the long term, whether in terms of energy security, in looking at local ownership of energy, and it will make a big difference. But they are in their infancy, these stages. We still haven't seen any of them go through to completion. So they do add a valuable tool in the kit to actually start ensuring that renewables could provide the future, the 100% delivery that we were talking about. Since on its own, it's not possible.
Is anyone else want to come in? No, that's fine.
Okay, Mike, did you have a supplementary?
Yeah, thank you, convener. I just wondered, I was in Orkney last weekend, and there's quite a number of electric cars there now, and similarly on the island of Mull. And I'd been reading that in Norway, over 30% of cars are now electric. And I just wondered what opportunity you felt to decarbonise transport there was in the use of electric vehicles. Also bearing in mind that when you look at new technology of any sort, the uptake of even the most successful technologies doesn't tend to be linear. It tends to be a hyperbolic curve. And it seems to me that we could be on the cusp of larger scale electrification of vehicles. Bearing in mind I live and represent a very rural area where I can assure you it's just not credible for me to walk to work, and no matter how fit I get, I'm never going to be able to cycle to work. Do you feel electric vehicles are an opportunity, and do you welcome what the Scottish Government is doing to try and promote the use of electric vehicles?
I would be much happier with the Scottish Government emphasising electric vehicles as the kind of last mile delivery for goods and services, particularly for the, when you look at the growth in carbon emissions from light goods vehicles, that curve goes up at a really, really dramatic angle, which I'm sure is the result of internet shopping, that type of thing, which is fine. But I think that what I would be really, really keen on would be to see how we can get commercial vehicles electrified, particularly instead of the diesel emitting or diesel powered engines for light goods vehicles, we move to an electric one. My concern with electric cars, and I take your point about the rural context, I do. However, the statistics are very clear for transport in Scotland. The vast majority of car trips, even in rural areas, rural local authorities, are short. So within our towns in rural areas, my concern with electric cars is we're simply moving the fuel source and we're not decongesting the roads, for example, so they'll remain congested, and we're not giving people an option to get out and walk and cycle, which improves their health. So in that urban context, in that town context, I'm much more cautious about electric cars, but I'm enthusiastic about electric goods vehicles, and I would like to see the government do more, much, much more on that front.
Can I also have a go at answering? Firstly, to say very much do support the Scottish Government's action plan for electric vehicles. All the work that we've done and any other work that I've read that tries to paint a picture of what the 2050 world would look like has a large role for electric vehicles in it. I think one of the key findings that came from a piece of work that we commissioned from Element Energy was the number of electric vehicles that you need in order to fulfil your climate change requirements will depend on the extent to which you've also complemented those with wider sustainable transport measures. So we would need 350,000 electric vehicles by 2030 in Scotland if we stabilise traffic levels at 2010 levels, if I get that right. Basically, the demand management, if you stabilise your traffic growth, the number of electric vehicles that you'll need will be considerably less. It will be 1.5 million just to achieve the same emissions reduction. So if you want to, if the Scottish Government sees a role for itself in supporting the deployment of new technology and to ensure that that investment is best spent to deliver the best return. It has to be matched by complementary measures in the wider transport system to reduce demand. And so you mentioned Norway, which is a great example of where there's been very rapid uptake in electric vehicles. That's in part because of the tax incentives that they're able to do, which aren't available to the Scottish Government. But it's also because of the exemptions that electric vehicles are afforded to congestion charging. So your major Norwegian cities will make it very attractive to drive your electric vehicle in. Now, that would rub up against issues of congestion, but they also happen to have better infrastructure for active travel, cycling and walking. So they can be part of a urban kind of a transport system, but they do need that whole holistic kind of approach if we're to support them in the right way. And one area that we're seeing investment in, which is very sensible at the moment, and you can see it around Edinburgh with Edinburgh City Council electric vehicle vans going around, fleet cars, taxis, Dundee's doing some interesting work around electric vehicle and taxis. So there are areas where you can make targeted impact, which would do an awful lot to mitigate the emissions associated with those types of vehicle use and those transport journeys.
Thank you.
Adam. Sorry, it's Alex. My apologies.
Well, got that far already, have we? I wanted to look a bit at the quality of the information that we're being given and our ability to effectively evaluate the expenditure on infrastructure. First of all, can you tell us if you believe that we're being given the right information in order to evaluate the effectiveness of policies?
I'll have a first stab. I think sometimes we get the right information, but at the wrong time. So, for instance, with regards to the publication of the budget, typically we get level four figures which relate to, if you're interested in understanding the extent to which the budget matches the requirements of the report on proposals and policies, it's those level four figures that are useful. They typically come out anything up to 4 weeks after the draft budget has been published, quite often after committees have taken evidence and their scrutiny has passed. So that's a real issue and has been repeatedly raised by ourselves and by other witnesses and picked up by various committees, both this one, I think, and the Energy Committee. And yet we still see this delay between the publication of the budget and those figures that relate specifically to what the report on proposals and policy says. But we also have a bigger challenge with that document, the Climate Change Action Plan, that RPP, in understanding the effectiveness of the policies that it's got in there. It attributes emission savings to different policy lines, and yet we don't have, as far as I'm aware, a very rich and accurate monitoring system that lets us know whether or not the assumptions in the RPP are bearing out. So we're continuing to make, and organisations like WWF will continue to advocate for support according to what the RPP says, but we're at stages of delivery now with many of these policy areas where we need to have a more reflective understanding of what's effective, what's hitting barriers, where the challenges are, so that we can understand just how effective the RPP assumptions are.
Might I also add something, particularly in around the carbon accounting? Because in the very early days, particularly around the strategic transport assessment and the carbon accounts that were created for that, they were quite simple, but they were state of art at the time. And I think the key also for some of the information is it's partly about timing, as Dr. Gardner said, but then it's also about as the innovation and methodologies to work out what is actually happening from various decisions moves forward, actually picking up those new techniques and applying them. And I guess that's why one of the messages from me being here today is that there are tools and techniques that at the moment are innovative and only tried by a few people, but as they become more refined, then there's an opportunity to actually do some quite sophisticated accounting, and in particular to start matching up those different activities and actually see what, taken as a whole, what does the carbon account look like. And with that in mind, one of the things that we found as an institution when we were trying to understand, is this bioheat plant the best thing to do for a low carbon piece of infrastructure? It ended up being much more complicated than we ever imagined. It hasn't stopped us doing it because we we still believe it's the right thing for us as an institution to do, but what has led us to be much more nuanced about is how we might influence a broader system to actually also make it the right decision for the whole of the carbon system for Scotland and beyond. So it really speaks to Mr. McKenzie's point about the electric vehicles. If you've got something sound in place, and you've got the infrastructure to have something sound in place, that is, evaluation of it will change as the electric cars in that instance change themselves, but also as our ability to account for them changes as well. And I think those two things need to move alongside each other.
Are the carbon accounting methods being used by the Scottish Government to evaluate their policies as up-to-date, as cutting-edge as they could be or as they need to be in order to assess policy effectively?
No, not yet. But I guess that's also another reason to give evidence, because in some ways they're probably as up-to-date as they can be given the understanding about how to do carbon accounting from, say, 4 or 5 years ago. But I think there's an opportunity for the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government to sort of leap forward and get onto, if you like, the cutting edge of it, as that's slowly but surely emerging. And one of the other problems is that with the carbon accounts within the Scottish system, is that there are many different ones. Each of them do different things. And so a better clarity about what the carbon accounts do is quite important. And if I could maybe illustrate that with a very clear example from the Climate Change Act, there's a requirement to produce production carbon. So what carbon is emitted in this country? At the same time, the Climate Change Act requires a consumption carbon figure to be tabled each year. And whilst the production carbon is drawing back, the consumption carbon is increasing. Now, obviously, the control that Scotland might have over those two modes, if you like, is quite different. But having the conversation about how these different accounts look when you reflect on each other is by far the most important thing, because that's where the learning comes from.
So what are the limitations of the current carbon accounting methods being used by the Scottish Government? And as well as limitations, are there any areas where there are inaccuracies creeping in that we should be aware of going forward?
Okay. I'd say there are three areas where there might be limitations that could be addressed. The first one is the extent to which and this has been spoken about already, the infrastructure plans and the RPP are not fully integrated together and sort of played out as to how these things fit together. If those policy aspects could be better fitted together, the carbon accounts associated with them could also be better fitted together. So as an accountant, our contribution, if you like, is to put information behind better quality decisions and joined up aspects of considering transport and heating and all the elements together. The second limitation is that, and particularly in previous sessions we have looked at the carbon account of the budget, that carbon account is produced but it doesn't seem to inform any decisions. Mm. So the accounting to the decision nexus is quite often missing. And so I would say that's a limitation. Not for all forms of the carbon accounting, because obviously the production accounts and what we might need to do under Section 36, etc., is joined up, if you like, to decisions, even if the timing might be somewhat delayed in the present moment. The third element of the limitations then is the understanding of what the carbon accounting might be telling us. That's a limitation that we all share. It's not solely the
We can all interpret.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And I think that's where a partnership approach between the folk who are very good in this field and people making the decision on the ground would be necessary. Because like most new forms of accounting, we have some idea about how they operate, but we couldn't truly know until you try them out, test them in real decision-making contexts. So along with innovation in technologies, accounting information is a technology of sort as well, and the innovation there relies on people experimenting with it as well. So I think there are the limitations of the underlining joined upness, the joined up of the carbon account decisions, and then the joined upness, if you like, of the ideas about how to do this well with the practice of doing it. So I think there's three elements in there.
And notwithstanding what I said a moment ago about interpretation, are there any elements of the accounting process which are now or in danger of in the future producing errors or inaccuracies in the figures that we interpret?
Some of the carbon accounting is pretty tight and pretty clear, and that's, if you like, the national level accounts that that the Climate Change Act targets and that the RPP looks at, for example. They're pretty tight. I guess the kind of areas where there are much more range of estimates, and you'll see from the paperwork that I presented, huge ranges of estimates, is more the what-if kind of questions. So if we did this, what might be the broader effect and what might be the dimensions of that broader effect? The error bars there are enormous. And so it's not so much the singular figure that's important, it's knowing that it is highly uncertain, which is probably the most valuable thing. So again, the level of accuracy and usefulness and reliability of different forms of carbon account are different as well. So some of them are very tight and really, you know, quite robust. Others, particularly the what-if type questions, are much looser. And there, knowing how big your ranges are probably the more important than what are the actual numbers at each end.
So these types of figures or interpretations would be more useful to us in a 1, 2, 3, 5-year cycle than
for example,
a 2050 cycle.
Yes. Yeah. But it's also, and this is where I think it does relate to the other points that people have made about infrastructure, is that even for us as a university, having a glimpse of how negative our positive choice to go for biomass might be on the broader system alerts us to maybe wanting to say something about land use policy and forestry policy as a way of supporting a micro-level good choice to be a bigger good choice as well. So I think it's not purely, you know, 3 to 5 years. It can be quite long-term views that be informed by that as well.
Going down to look on the micro level, I think it's really important that we look to evaluate Scottish Government programmes as they are ongoing. So if you look at the energy efficiency programmes, we are going to be repeating the installation of measures in 1.6 million homes. But are we learning from that? Because there must be ways that we can do things smarter, the use of different approaches to construction, possibly off-site construction. We're probably not doing enough to evaluate the effectiveness of our programmes. Are we getting the benefits of the measures that through people minimising the rebound effect, the efficient use of their heating as well. There are 32 local authorities delivering area-based schemes, and how much are we doing to coordinate shared learning from that so we can get the best from it to take advantage of it? We also have very different housing in Scotland compared to the rest of UK, and a lot of the overall approaches to assessing the energy efficiency is based on the UK level rather than taking into account the traditional build we have in Scotland with far more tenements or the much more exposed location. And there is the need for that research development to ensure that we make the best approaches to improving our housing and that we feed the practical experience into theoretical models to ensure that we make the best use of the large amounts of funding that is required to improve the energy efficiency.
Thank you.
The supplementary.
Professor Bebbington, probably, again, I'm afraid, because we were talking about Norway earlier on. Given that we've already changed the methodology for carbon accounting in Scotland, are any other countries ahead of us in this area? And how do we compare ourselves internationally if there are different levels of accounting across Europe and the world?
I don't have full view of all the carbon accounting going on, but the views that I do have into individual countries is that they're tending to do carbon accounting in association with the things they either do well or do badly. So the other place that I sort of follow with a bit of depth of knowledge is New Zealand. Their carbon accounting for particularly animal and agricultural produced CO2 equivalents is very sophisticated for obvious reasons. They have lots of ruminants, and that's where like 50% of their impact is agricultural for their carbon, so they're really focused on that. I think where Scotland, I think, is best in the world is because of the early innovation with the Climate Change Act and because of the RPP, but also because of the joined-upness and the size, then the integrating accounts of how everything links together is where a big potential lies. It's not fully realised, but that's where the excellence lies. So I don't think there's anywhere that's doing the whole thing better than here. But there are parts of the world that are doing, if you like, their problematic carbon better. So the whole nitrogen, carbon, land, water, flux, for example, is modelled superbly within New Zealand on an agricultural system basis. But that's because that's their problem, not, you know, they have quite different emission problems.
Thank you.
Thank you. Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask the witnesses if they can define the intrinsic benefits of low carbon infrastructure investments, the social, environmental, as well as economic benefits of that. And if you can define them, are they taken account of in the current budgetary system, or should they be? Who wants to go first?
I'll have a first up. So I think there is partial recognition of the broader benefits of the infrastructure decisions that the Scottish Government make with its capital investment decisions. I think the recognition of the benefits, particularly that low carbon infrastructure has to play, are acknowledged but not necessarily then borne out in the actual decision making. So we see language that reflects the value of low carbon infrastructure, but as Sara alluded to at the beginning, we still see only a 50% of our capital investment being aligned with low carbon infrastructure. So the work that the task force commissioned from Green Alliance to look at what particularly the role of the public sector was in catalysing investment in low carbon infrastructure, what the benefits were, identified particular attributes of the public sector's contribution to this type of infrastructure through, for instance, supporting enabling infrastructure. So one example would be district heating networks, which are necessary in order to connect isolated district heating communities. So you get greater benefits of scale. Support emerging infrastructure, such as energy storage, where there's a need for intervention to support that market and reduce the risk. Support innovative low-carbon technologies, which is, you know, Teresa provided an example previously of where the Scottish Government's challenge, the Energy Challenge Fund, is doing that. Obviously, leveraging additional private sector investment, there's evidence of that, significant evidence of that in the energy efficiency sector, where the public sector's investment can be shown to pull in significant returns from the private sector. And of course, addressing market failures, which is what this is all about, you know, the climate change problem being the biggest market failure, and the need of the public sector to either through investment or through regulation correct for that. So those are the particular roles that the public sector has to play in instigating or supporting greater deployment of low carbon infrastructure. Others might want to speak to the wider benefits that has to bring.
I'm happy to have a stab at the transport benefits, I think, of emphasising greater low carbon. We talked about electric vehicles. We have a major bus manufacturer in Scotland, and I think switching our buses to more electric buses would have a benefit straight away for that manufacturer. But in addition to that, if we have fewer short trips being made by car in an urban context, as you do in northern European cities, air quality improves. And at the moment, we have an issue about air quality in our towns and our cities, both in terms of a health implication, but also in terms of fines that local authorities are facing from Europe. In addition to that, all the evidence from towns and cities in northern Europe that have emphasised greater movement by low carbon method, so walking, cycling, bus provision, tram, whatever, in the public transport mode, show that those are towns and cities that people enjoy living in. They spend more time shopping in. There's more time spent in recreation within the town itself. It's a more prosperous town, more prosperous city, and there's lots of good examples about that. So I would see those as associated benefits of emphasising a greater level of low carbon in terms of transport.
Could I just follow up on the transport side of things? We heard mentioned earlier on about the Strategic Transport Projects Review, which is conducted on an ongoing basis. What I'm asking here is low carbon infrastructure, can it score higher or lower when taking into account, you know, which projects we should be prioritising? I've got a project in my constituency which is a bypassing Maybole, which is, people have been campaigning for about 50 years on road safety, congestion, economic grounds for such a bypass, and I would, that is not a low carbon infrastructure project, but I would score it very highly. Mm-hmm. So I'm asking you, you know, why should a low carbon infrastructure project be scored higher than that particular one?
So why should a low carbon, oh I see, so rather than fund the bypass, you fund something else? Yeah.
Well, I'd rather that didn't happen, I have to say.
I understand. Well, I think in terms of the scoring, and in terms of the Scottish Transport Appraisal Guidance, my understanding is that time savings is a big driver for assessment there, which is, I don't think it takes everything into the round. I think it has to be seen, everything has to be seen in the thing about transport is everything has to be seen in the context of where that project is and the effect that it has. And there's no kind of one rule that's going to fix it all. So I don't want to deny you your bypass. And there might be lots of benefits. As you say, there'll be health benefits and other benefits to Maybole as well, not just in terms of benefits, of other time-saving benefits in terms of goods vehicles getting through. But at the moment, I don't think that low-carbon capital infrastructure investment does score very highly. So it doesn't really feature in the strategic transport projects review at all.
Observation that really supports Ms. Bray's earlier point about behaviour change in households, but particularly perhaps relay what we're trying to, you know, track in a research sense at the institution where I work. What we're trying to do is to take our energy bills basically in-house, which will have an economic benefit, given that we're working on a variable but fairly fixed income, and so we'll be able to, you know, spend more money on our core purpose as opposed to on electricity. And so there's an economic benefit for us as an institution as we invest in low-carbon infrastructure, although, you know, it takes a lot of investment, but it will pay back. But I think where there's further spillover effects that we're identifying through a series of other research projects, one is a spillover effect in terms of how people who work for us view their energy saving behaviours both at home and at work. And so it really sort of follows very much an I will if you will kind of ethos, in that if our institution is seen as trying to reduce our own carbon footprint, then they feel much more motivated to be part of the behaviour change that's required of people working for us to actually help support that as well. And many of our staff take that from their home life, come into work, and then almost see it being, you know, if it's been ignored at work, then they're not motivated to do that. So the fact that we're trying to innovate in low carbon infrastructure as an organisation is really enthusing staff, are seeing themselves, if you like, as part of a bigger work and home, you know, seeking to address these issues. What we're also finding is that we use ourselves as a case study for a lot of our teaching with our students. As you know, if we're going to particularly, this is where different forms of carbon become quite important, we have quite a large international cohort of students, and their footprint of them coming and going from us for their education is actually quite large, and we have a sense of what that is. And even though it's their footprint, our behaviour induces it, and indeed the wish for a world-class education system will induce transport carbon. But at the same time, we think that there is something to be said for bringing students, particularly from countries that maybe are not so advanced in thinking about climate change, to a country which is innovating in a series of ways. So for us, a big spillover effect of our own innovation, but also the innovation in Scotland, is the ability to teach and communicate and take that back with other students. And so, for example, our Russian students are always amazed by recycling. They've never seen it before. And so whilst we may occasionally beat ourselves up at being not very good at most things, we're really good at lots of things. Likewise, the whole idea that you might start building low carbon infrastructure, you know, the charging points for electric vehicles outside various parts of the university. So those spillover effects, if you like, as being an exemplar and seeking to articulate what we're doing as a nation or as an organisation are also important in knowledge terms.
I think the energy efficiency programme is very different from any other capital programme. You're looking at carrying out works to 60% of the housing stock in Scotland that is below the required standard. So that's affecting millions of people. And it's not just when they occasionally drive down the A9 or whatever. It's every day of their life that they will be benefiting from the improvement of the energy efficiency of their homes. And that does lead through to a number of things. It's across Scotland, so you're looking for jobs across Scotland. You're looking for long-term jobs as well. They're currently not the people there to do those, who've got the skills to do the jobs. There will have to be a big training up of people to do that job to ensure those jobs remain within Scotland. But if you have a long-term programme, people see that as something to invest for the future. So you've got jobs across Scotland. The health benefits, a number of people are underheating their homes, which results in respiratory issues, particularly amongst the elderly population and young children. There will be direct benefits there through to the health service on it. You then look to see that there will be savings in people's individual amount people are spending on energy, which allows them to invest in other things within the local economy as well. It is very labour intensive compared to sort of a high tech approaches, which means that that money stays in Scotland. So I think it is a very different programme because of its widespread nature. You're not spending that much on any individual home. It's not, but it is large amounts when you do it at the scale that we're proposing that it needs to be done.
So do you, these effects, other effects, if you like, do you think they're taken account of when it comes to budgetary decisions?
I don't have the detailed knowledge of how these get taken into account. I think it's very unlikely it is because it's so different a programme from any of the other big infrastructure programmes. It's much easier to evaluate the benefits of putting in the fourth road bridge compared to doing huge works across all our housing stock.
Well, that begs the question, should these other all these factors be taken into account when we're making capital investment decisions? Dr. Gardner.
Absolutely, they should be. I think all of this...
So how do we gather that information? How do we put it into the system?
I think there needs to be a explicit recognition of the longer-term benefits or costs associated with decision-making for our infrastructure and a greater effort to account for the preventative spend consequences that can be attached to infrastructure decisions that we make today. So a big thrust of the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force work is to recognise or to highlight that the decisions we'll be making now will be those that we are living with in 2050. If we make the wrong decisions now and we lock ourselves into the high carbon infrastructure that contradicts the Climate Change Act, we will have to spend considerably more money to retrofit that and to fix it. And yet that longer-term perspective needs to be brought to bear on the infrastructure decisions. So this is an observation, I don't know if it's right, but there's often a sense that the policy decisions within the RPP are considered in the context of the Climate Change Act. There isn't the same explicit acknowledgement with the capital budget, and the infrastructure budget isn't so closely aligned to delivering on the Climate Change Act. It doesn't have that same read across, the same effort to try and match one with the other. And I think there are some things that could be done, such as ensuring that there is a carbon price on our transport projects, which would go a long way to recognising the long-term costs of some of the road-building programmes and what's associated with those, and would elevate up those active travel investments that would also, if we also accounted for the improvement in the air quality that we'd experience in our urban environments, would also bring those right to the top. So it's where you draw your boundaries around the consequences of your infrastructure decisions. And at the moment, I fear that we draw them too narrowly. And as a result, we prioritise short-term investments on big bits of kit over distributed investments across Scotland that would have long-term benefits. Okay, and just one example, just to say that on energy efficiency, analysis has shown that offers a return on investment of 2-1. So it's very competitive when stacked up against other traditional infrastructure investments.
Okay, thank you. Does the Low Carbon Task Force have any views on this?
Well, actually, I think Sam has very eloquently expressed those, but actually I wanted to make the observation that the committee really is putting its finger on the nub of the problem here, because Scottish Government is trying to mainstream climate change considerations, but it's also trying to balance those with economic considerations, and it's your bypass, it's things like that. But the economic considerations don't necessarily sit naturally with a low-carbon pathway, so investment in new roads infrastructure, for example. But I think that the points that Jan was making around having, you know, better read across between the infrastructure investment plans and RPP, and actually thinking about social infrastructure and the impacts on social infrastructure spend. So we've all touched on this, the spending down the line, which happens as a result of not having taken the low carbon infrastructure decision. If we could get better at capturing that, counting that, and building that into our infrastructure decision making, it would be extremely valuable. I don't know if Jan has any thoughts on how that might be done or achieved.
Again, there are techniques, social accounting techniques. I mean, one of the things that occurs to me, particularly in around the energy efficiency, is that you could put a social account alongside that. So given increasing warmth, increasing well-being, what's the human benefit of that? And should you wish to, you'd be able to model and get some sort of guess on the reduced health costs that are borne by economically, but also the health costs that maybe don't represent in the economic system, but are borne by people. So I think it's a particular program where a realization of those multitude of benefits that come from low carbon, and low carbon being pro-social as well, might be a very interesting case study to set up. You know, quite a study around that.
You'd be pitching for that.
Oh no, I'm pitching for this lady because she's the person that's the expert to do it.
Okay, Mike.
Thank you, convener. I suppose my first question is probably largely directed to Teresa Bray, because you know the Scottish Government has made a commitment to making energy efficiency and infrastructure priority, but and you'll probably know that the First Minister's already announced a significant part of our manifesto in terms of a commitment to build 50,000 affordable homes over the course of the next Parliament. And given that those new homes will have to comply with Part 6 of the energy standard, efficiency part of the building standards, they really are energy efficient compared to older housing from a previous era. So I just wonder to what extent you feel that we can do that with low housing, with new housing, in terms of reducing our carbon output. But also, I think we've made significant progress along the lines you suggest of increasing the number of energy performance certificates at C or above over the last few years. I wonder if you could confirm that. But what bothers me also is that, you know, we're reaching a kind of problem area, I feel, with the existing housing stock, that we've picked much of the low-hanging fruit. Over 60% of accessible lofts have been insulated. Over 60% of cavities have been insulated. And given that we've got maybe 800,000 or more of our homes, are 30% or so, in that hard-to-treat category, you know, how much more yield realistically in carbon terms and in energy efficiency terms can we get from the older housing stock? And my final point just on that same theme is that, you know, the committee's dealing with the private rented sector bill at the moment. And, you know, landlords, for instance, that are responsible and spend a lot of money insulating their properties and you know, doing all this kind of work, don't get a penny more in rent for it. Nor do the people, nor the social housing landlords, you know, get higher rents for well insulated properties, despite the fact the tenants have significant savings in fuel bills. In terms of house sales, You know, houses that are well insulated don't command higher prices necessarily, despite the energy performance certificates. So to what extent do you think market forces in not being aligned and not being sensitive to energy efficiency, you know, are actually unhelpful, and how can they be made to help? So I appreciate I'm touching on a lot of areas. I'll move on to other territory with my next question. But, you know, I just wonder if you could address these points and also any other panel members.
Yep. I don't dispute there's the need for new housing. New housing is not actually replacing existing housing in the accepted exceptional cases, but we need new housing because of population growth, because of changes in household size, and that yes, there's desperate need for new housing for everybody to live in. But there's the vast majority of the stock that's going to be here in 2050 has already been built. Over 80% of that stock's there, so there is that need to it. We talked about low-hanging fruit. It's probably only the lowest of the low-hanging fruit that has been addressed. There still are the figures I think are actually probably slightly better than you say in terms of lofts and cavities. But it's see how we can overcome those issues to do with lofts. And lots of them are not actually that difficult issues about hard-to-treat lofts. You can do access. There are things about tenements that we still have. A lot of tenement lofts have not been insulated. And that is not because of technological difficulties, but it's how do you engage with householders? You've got multiple occupation there. Are there the use that we should be using making of the Tenement Act to actually get that done? There are lots of practical things that can be done, but it's actually that organising of the market as much as anything to make it happen. Though we have done very little on our pre-1919 stock, and that's not to say things cannot be done on that stock. It is good housing for the majority of it, the tenements that we have or the older housing. And there are things that can be done. The new approaches, which Historic Scotland are looking at, there are issues about the ventilation within those houses. Sort of, there are things that have stopped sort of putting in double glazing within historic properties, that there are now ways of overcoming that. So there are things to be done which are not that difficult to do, and perhaps not quite as easy as a standard insulation of a loft or standard cavities, but there are things that we can be done and are not sort of a step change in the level of expenditure that's required. There will be some properties that probably are such poor condition that you should not be looking at insulating, and that they shouldn't be continued to be lived in. It's a very small proportion of the housing, but there are some, particularly houses that have been extended numerous times and have never had a proper work done to them. So there are things that need being done. But going on to your further question about valuing energy efficiency, I think the real difficulty with one of the reasons why energy efficiency is not valued and so you cannot add to the price is because there's so little housing there that it's that the looking at the rental properties, people just need a house to rent or a flat to rent, and they cannot put the value on that. There are issues about house prices as well, that it's very much driven by location on that. And if you were able to choose between two houses with all the same factors, energy efficiency may come to it. But the way the market is currently operating, there are too many conflicting demands. There's not enough supply to be able to make those choices there. With regard to the private rented sector, some of that housing is in the worst condition, and there are real issues about the return that's been made by private sector landlords on housing, and the housing that they are letting is substandard. There is the need for minimum standards to ensure at the point of rent or the point of sale that those properties are bought up to what should be considered as an acceptable level of housing for people to live in. And that there is, unless we introduce minimum standards, that's not going to happen. And it's not just about energy efficiency. There are issues about disrepair in a lot of our private renting stock. Our private rented stock is the worst stock that we have in Scotland, and there's a need to improve that. With the returns that are happening to private landlords and the low interest rates, there's very little justification to say they should be looking at higher rents to support that. They can afford to do it, and there's a need to ensure that that happens.
And if I could just tease out one further issue that's kind of allied to what you know we've been discussing. I've heard that there was an energy expert advised a constituent of mine recently with an older traditional home just to knock it down and build a new one, and it was on the basis that this home was in the hard to treat. And when I talked about hard to treat, I wasn't just talking about loft spaces, accessible or otherwise. I was talking about the whole home, because I'm sure you'll agree with me, it's important to insulate the complete envelope of the building, not just the loft space. And what concerns me here, and I think what this energy expert was getting at, that in terms of the achievable U values, you know, watts per metre squared per degree Kelvin, something like that, that it just wasn't good value, you know, to treat this home in terms of the available, the opportunity of increasing its insulation just didn't make sense, neither in economic terms or energy terms, by comparison with building the equivalent new home. Do you feel there's some merit in that argument?
It's always a difficult thing to say that somebody's home is no longer fit for purpose. We have some of the oldest stock in the world in the UK. If you look at some of the remote properties in rural areas, you've often had small button bairn, it's had the extension added in for the kitchen, it's had a loft conversion, and lots of things it's just making do. There will be some housing that is not fit for the 21st century. It may not also not meet accessibility standards as people get older. Can those houses be adapted so they can maintain living in their homes? Energy efficiency, if you're going to be spending £30,000 on doing up a house that is actually may well be in the wrong location, and without accessibility standards as well, that not all homes will probably be able to pay. But it's a very small minority of homes. You start looking at, it's only 2% of homes in Scotland that are the lowest energy efficiency G rated. Those are the ones which, yes, sometimes you can do things on to those homes, but for a few of them, you probably say, actually, are we better building a new high quality energy efficiency home that has accessibility with it to other issues, to other services as well, instead of being 2 miles out of the local hamlet, that they're actually able to access some other people as well. We do have to occasionally question, should we be building all homes? We've seen that within some of the housing stock, which was built in the pre-war, some of the tower blocks. We've accepted that housing is no longer acceptable. Perhaps in other housing, we have to at times do that.
Yeah, thank you. That's very useful because... certainly can be there.
Mr. Lauder.
Just with mention of housing, I think I would like to just to make mention of transport and transport connections, particularly when we're building a new estate or a new group of houses. If we're building them in a location, if we lock in the need to use the car for every trip, so we don't give at least some option to get to either a transport hub or ensure that there's sufficient design put in to allow a bus route to be through the estate, then I think we may undo the energy efficiency of the housing stock. By then, people feel, well, the only option I've got is to take the car, no matter how short the journey is. So I do think we need to give a bit of thought to that. And it does strike me that the Scandinavian experience does very much seem to be that the transport links are the first thing that go in and are considered. And then the housing is designed around that, so that new build is as accessible and as well linked as it can be to the local area.
That's a very interesting point. I'm very grateful to you for mentioning that, because we're undertaking a root and branch review of the planning system at the moment. And do you feel that there's actually quite a yield, you know, a lot of potential gain here in terms of thinking, you know, rather than spending the money, in terms of how we plan the next 50 years of built environment and infrastructure, perhaps we go back to and learn lessons from our forefathers, where people primarily walked to work because the housing was close to the place of work.
Yeah.
You know, as well as some of the close to the transport hub issues. And do you think that perhaps without much expenditure at all, we could make some real gains?
Yes, I do. And I think that the policy that we have, the planning policy called Designing Streets in Scotland, is an exemplary policy, very, very good. And if we were delivering all new build to that design, then we would have a grid pattern, linear builds that would allow people to access. And I totally appreciate in the modern world people don't necessarily live near where they work. We have kind of built in commuting and sometimes long distance commuting into our housing developments. Where I think we have missed an option is that where we're creating new public transport links, like new rail lines that are being reopened, and roads, we're not doing enough to ensure that we're building links from the new housing stock to those to allow people to use public transport and then for the onward journey. I think that does take you another point, which is how joined up is public transport? So is it possible to make, you know, a more seamless journey via walking or cycling to a transport hub? Frequent visitor to Switzerland, where it's very, very easy, even in quite small towns, to make a very well joined up journey. So you can walk, you can get a bus, or you can walk, you can get a train, and you pretty much know the whole thing is joined up. I don't think we've designed that into our housing planning. I also think that we've had, but perhaps designing streets will help that. Perhaps the planning system could do more to encourage greater building on brownfield within the urban setting, rather than continually build outside the town so that the town continually grows and we compromise the green belt so that just distances become greater. It might be possible for us to make distances much shorter.
Dr. Gardner, did you want to come in?
Yeah, very quickly, just to go back to the energy efficiency point and to try and unpick the real value of the designation of energy efficiency as a national infrastructure priority, which is a particularly welcome commitment, is how it changes the nature of the approach to energy efficiency from being an annual cycle of kind of uncertainty around what the budget might be and an absence of any clear goal to hopefully providing a very clear outcome, which the Scottish Government will provide. We would urge them to set that goal as being a minimum of a C by 2025. But by establishing that very goal-orientated approach, it puts the energy efficiency programme on the same kind of standing as other infrastructure projects where you would never envisage kind of pursuing a bridge development without knowing where it's going to end. So we should take the same approach to our energy efficiency structure. We need to know what that goal is. It will provide a very clear market signal that will help ensure that we get that training and upskilling, because there's a clear market being created as a consequence of that level of ambition. So it was really to kind of reinforce the value of that designation, but say that it needs to be complemented by a clear outcome so that everyone knows what we're working towards.
Anyone else? Ms. Thiam.
I just wanted to add to John's comments. In our long list of 10 projects, low carbon transport hubs is one of them, as well as re-engineering city centres. But equally to the housing question, transport location, the location of public transport is vital, but equally so is water supply and energy supply needs to be taken into the mix when we're looking at planning policy.
I'll maybe move on, though, because that kind of ties in quite neatly to my next question, which is really about what infrastructure areas that you feel should be priority areas for government in terms of spending, but also in terms of other government policy. We've touched on planning. Are there other spending areas, but also complementary policy areas where we can achieve greater effect?
Of the 10 long list projects, they roughly divide into three categories. One is transport, the second is energy and looking at district heating and so on, and the third is energy efficiency and looking at energy from wastewater and growing local energy economies and so on. So these are in taking the evidence and looking at the peer review of the 10 projects, I think actually we've begun to realise that the project, identifying it down to a list of three from 10 is probably not going to be what we thought. In a way, these are straw men, if you like, these projects. But looking at them in the round has enabled us to understand the systems approach. It's exactly what Jan is saying about the systems approach to this. You do not take one don't take a decision on one of these projects without it impacting on one of the others. So in fact, I think the shortlist that we might end up with will look very different to how we'd perhaps envisaged it. So we may have a transport one, an energy one, an energy storage, energy efficiency one.
Can I to take it back to where the emissions are, so I said earlier how 50% of our emissions are from the heat sector. It's an area that is crying out for leadership and investment. It's an area where there's an absence of private sector investment. There's a lack of confidence as to what the development of that sector will be in the future. Obviously, there's uncertainties that come from Westminster, and we may hear this afternoon about the future of things like the renewable heat incentive. But there is a very clear case, I think, to be made for the Scottish Government combining its planning and its regulatory powers with targeted investment of its capital infrastructure in order to bring together isolated heat pockets, district heating pockets. So Edinburgh is an example of where there's a number of district heating bits of infrastructure that, if they were combined, would offer the potential for other heat loads to connect to those. And that won't happen in the absence of, I suspect, support from the public sector in the provision of that pipe work. And the other area, which is will sound a little repetitive, I suspect, but just to highlight, you know, how the emissions from the transport sector are pretty much the same now as they were in 1990, and they've come down. Well, they've that's despite the fact that we've had growth in car kilometres, but the reason that they're the same as they were is largely because of efficiencies that have been driven by EU kind of directives. So we do need to start to plan our infrastructure to support low carbon behaviours if we're to drive down those emissions. And I refer back to how the RPP indicates an expectation of a 300% increase in emission savings in the forthcoming years. Infrastructure decisions won't kind of secure that. Policy decisions will have to do that. But longer term, it's an indication of the level of change that we're going to have to see within our transport infrastructure. So one of the infrastructure projects that the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force, we didn't identify these. These came from Jacobs. We commissioned Jacobs Engineering Firm to canvass opinion amongst different stakeholders. One of them was the upgrading and improvement of our existing rail network. So, for instance, looking at how do we, the line from Perth to Inverness, which is, for all those that have to travel on it, is subject to any number of different problems, as you might get held up by other trains because it's single carriage at various ways, various points along the line. So looking at opportunities there to increase the capacity of our existing rail network is a clear example of where we need to make the alternative to the car a more attractive proposition. And that's a place where the Scottish Government's infrastructure budget could be well targeted.
Thank you.
Mr. Lauder.
Yeah, again, at the risk of repeating an earlier point, forgive me if I do, I think that where transport sometimes works in isolation is it doesn't look at, for example, the health implications. Not just in air pollution, which is definitely having an effect, and that there's a figure of £2 billion being the cost to the economy of failing air pollution. But in addition to that, congestion. But in terms of health, we're now looking, as I understand it from the Chief Medical Officer, at 10% of the NHS budget being spent on treating symptoms of obesity, a big driver for which is inactivity and the inability to be able to just have everyday walk and everyday cycling to and from the places that you go to and you might use your car. So I think there's a major implication for transport there in helping health to hit its targets and reduce the burden on its budget. And I think those two things could be combined much, much more closely. I don't think that they necessarily are at the moment. There's a very useful tool produced by the World Health Organization called the HEAT tool, Health Economic Assessment Tool, which is used. It's the point that I wanted to make earlier, convener. And I'm not sure that tool is used in the appraisal of transport projects, particularly small local transport projects. We do use it in the evidence we give to the Sustainable and Active Travel team, whose funds we manage. And they give, for example, benefit to cost ratios of £13 to £1 spent, which is pretty good return on investment. So I think that's maybe a tool that could be used more widely, and it would bring together health and transport. So I think that's a complementary benefit of a greater investment in active travel in terms of walking and cycling.
Thank you. Could you be brief, please?
That'll be brief, yes. Are there any investment programmes that have already been undertaken by the Scottish Government that are maybe that have been very effective and that we can perhaps magnify, expand, roll out across Scotland?
Yeah, the project that we've now been running for 5 years is called Community Links. It's growing, and it's growing every year in terms of the funds that we manage. It's a match-funded partnership between local authorities and other stakeholders and Transport Scotland. We act, if you like, as the holder for that budget. And every year we're oversubscribed with ideas. I've mentioned the benefit-to-cost ratios. I think they are very successful. It's been a pivotal project in helping Edinburgh, for example, get to where it's getting to now. And that's a very good evidence. And in addition to that, there's growing evidence from other towns and cities that that programme is actually beginning to have an effect. It's early days. It's only 5 years, so the data set is not substantial enough to make a big assessment on. But, yes, I think that's a project that is going well and is seen as a success throughout the UK.
Thank you very much.
Very quickly, just to flag how the district heating loan has been a competitive process, and we've seen investments in district heating across Scotland as a consequence. They do need to be brought together and, where possible, enlarged so that it's not too isolated, but we're getting network development rather than isolated district heating. But that's a fund that's would be great if it was able to continue. And then finally, just to say that energy efficiency now is a programme that, albeit we would say that the funding hasn't been adequate, but it's beginning to show its benefits. We're beginning to see year on year the number of properties which have had loft insulation or cavity wall coming out. So you're beginning to see the impact of that. What we're urging is that that isn't at a scale that will reap the transformative benefits that it can offer, but there's a lot of learning from that and a lot of benefits that have been enjoyed as a consequence of the existing programmes that we've got on energy efficiency.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we'll move on. Adam.
What's the converse of that? What infrastructure investments should be avoided in the future if we are concerned about achieving our targets, the climate change targets?
I think infrastructure that supports high carbon behaviours, that is dependent. So a road building programme which envisages that all of those roads will be low carbon because they'll have electric vehicles driving on them isn't a kind of coherent vision of the 2050 future that we're heading towards. You can't replicate existing car use with electric vehicle car use. So a road building programme that is dependent on the mass deployment of EVs at the scale that we see internal combustion engines being enjoyed today doesn't square up. So we have to see a greater realignment of our trunk road investment towards those bits of infrastructure that, as we've talked throughout this session, offer wider benefits, not just the low carbon benefits, but the wider health benefits. John talked about the obesity challenge that Scotland faces and the UK faces. So we need to kind of step back from the perspective that we often bring to our infrastructure decisions and try and see them further in the round. And I think that if we did that, we'd begin to be a lot more critical of some of the decisions that we've made in the last 10 years or so and see the benefits of the alternatives.
Okay. All right.
Anyone else?
Reinforce that point, because I don't think there's a list of things you would never seek to do, because infrastructure has multiple aspects to it, be social, economic and whatnot. But I think Dr. Gardner's point is that you would look very carefully at design and actually not take normal design for granted. And I think that's maybe also part of the hesitancy around this table. You say, what would you stop doing? Well, it's invidious to choose what you'd stop doing, but anything you had to do, you'd have to do much better. I think that's probably maybe sums up where we're at.
In that vein, it's been suggested that an independent Scottish Infrastructure Commission should be set up in order to more effectively direct infrastructure investments, both the public and private sectors, towards a low-carbon Scotland. Do you agree with this initiative, and could you explain how it might work?
I think it was in our evidence, so perhaps I should have a go at explaining it. So yes, I agree that this is a sensible suggestion. It is a suggestion, but I think one of the points that I think is behind a lot of what we've talked about today is around governance and decision making and integration and being able to see the whole when making decisions. And part of the reason that the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force came about was because we weren't observing the existence of a pipeline of low carbon infrastructure projects. And so it was a response to what we regarded as a need to identify those projects. And I think there is a need for that infrastructure development and that plan to be taken forward in such a way as to ensure we have confidence that it's consistent with the Climate Change Act. And that requires some scrutiny, whether that be an independent commission or a separate governance process that the Scottish Government establishes would be open to debate. But I think bringing expert opinion into the room that understands the infrastructure challenges that we're facing as we make the transition to a low carbon economy, can see where the need is most pressing, can see where the Scottish Government has a particular role to play to catalyse change, I think would be really advantageous.
Ms. Thiam?
Since our President, Sir John Armitt, who's in town later on today, is a commissioner on the National Infrastructure Commission, it won't surprise you to learn that the Institution of Civil Engineers, at any rate, thinks that infrastructure commissions are a good idea, largely because the life cycle of infrastructure, as this committee understands only too well, runs beyond parliamentary terms and requires cross-party support in many instances if it's to be delivered effectively, if it's to be designed, planned and delivered effectively. But equally, if you're going to make decisions around looking very carefully at the why and actually looking at maintaining existing infrastructure rather than building new, and actually making decisions about when you don't build new infrastructure. So I think that it remains to be seen the extent to which Scottish Government or how Scottish Government will relate to the National Infrastructure Commission, or indeed exactly what the National Infrastructure Commission means. Is that a UK-wide infrastructure commission, or whether indeed there should be a separate Scottish Infrastructure Commission? The types of issues that the National Infrastructure Commission is looking at in the first year, perhaps don't seem at first sight particularly of relevance to Scotland. However, since they're looking at Northern Powerhouse cross Pennine transport and so on. However, I would, certainly the issues around energy and energy storage are of keen interest to us in Scotland, particularly since we have a great deal of expertise, and indeed the energy storage, much of it is in Scotland, in the UK. But also the cross-border rail is of particular interest to us, and high-speed rail and transport issues like that, which could...
What are the benefits of having the commission, and how much would it cost to establish that in Scotland?
I would certainly be happy to come back to you on how much it might cost. I'm not clear what the costs are associated with it. I don't think that they're of any great order of magnitude, since it's largely comprises of external experts who give off their time, and the institution will actually be supporting the Infrastructure Commission in terms of some of the national needs assessment work that it's doing. But in terms of benefits, having that arm's length body for governance from government who can give a clear sense of direction, who can try and get cross-party support around particular issues, and particularly when those issues are perhaps politically difficult to take, actually having an infrastructure commission advising government and trying to gain cross-party support on those types of issues can be a very valuable contribution. It's worked particularly well in countries like Australia and Canada, where they've had infrastructure commissions.
Okay, Alex, you had a brief supplementary.
I was just going to ask how we avoid the well-known situation where you set up a commission and it sets up a list of priorities and governments simply pick from that list based on their own political priorities.
I mean, I think it's interesting, actually, that the initial work on the Infrastructure Commission was, in fact, done by on behalf of the Labour Party by Sir John Armitt. And, in fact, it's been adopted more or less wholesale by the existing government in Scotland. But it's certainly a risk you identify. It's not quite sure how we overcome that one. That's politics, I guess.
Okay. Adam? Final question.
Just a final question. Scotland has sought to be a leading country in the world in terms of the climate change arena, and certainly we've been acknowledged by people like the United Nations as being a shining example, I think was the quotation. But of course we've got a way to go to fulfil that ambition. Can you suggest innovative ways that can put us in at the forefront in this field into the future?
From my sector, I can't offer you an innovative way. I think what we've seen in other small northern European countries is the way to go. So it's not terribly innovative. It might be innovative to us to follow the Swedish model. Perhaps one innovation is the Swedish model of aiming to have no fatalities on your roads. So Vision Zero is what it's called in Sweden. And that has meant a very radical redesign of how roads, streets, residential areas, shopping areas, speed limits, how speed limits are set and enforced, how roads are built, how they're maintained. So that would be innovative, I think. So that may be one to follow. And the rest of it is just good practice from other countries not so different to us.
That's interesting.
I would echo that and say that it's really not innovation that's required, but often leadership. We have world-leading climate legislation, but there are other countries around Northern Europe that have world-leading climate policies. And in many cases, they're the norm, and we can do an awful lot to learn from those, whether that be in district heating from Copenhagen, or which isn't to say that it's just automatically can be transferred wholesale over here and be applied, but there's learning that can be enjoyed. Similarly, in the transport, around where there's plenty of European cities which are able to demonstrate thriving, productive, enjoyable places to be that have very, very high levels of active travel. These are attractive cities to be in. So I would caution against a kind of search for innovation. There will be examples, particularly in the power sector, where there's a need for new technologies, but more often than not, it's the need to apply what we know is necessary. So demand management measures within the transport sector have been highlighted by the Committee on Climate Change. They've been highlighted by this committee in its previous considerations. They were in the very first draft of the report on proposals and policies, and yet they've never really featured and they've never come to the fore. And it seems it's perverse to think that we can secure the climate change targets, the low carbon economy, enjoy the benefits of a cleaner urban environment without matching our investment in public transport with also demand management measures to encourage people to get into that public transport.
I think one of the difficulties is we're not looking at a huge big project that you can have your stickers over to say that this is going to be a low carbon solution to all our needs. Lots of things we want to do are actually probably not going to be visible to anybody long term. If you carry out improve the energy efficiency, nobody sees it. The form of heating that we have, whether it's district heating or individual boilers, won't be seen. But I think the thing we should be looking to be really proud of is having a culture that embraces a low carbon approaches, that we start thinking about things that you start looking at one of the standard things about valuing the increase in house prices. That is not necessarily good for society. Actually having a culture that values the role that we're playing in society, that values the role that individuals can enjoy the cities they live in because of the low carbon approaches with active travel, that they can live in houses that they enjoy living in, that they're the public spaces that people enjoy. It will make a much better place for people to live in. It might not be something you can be as easy to assess. It will hopefully make people happier to live there. And that's what we should be looking to value, not having some large infrastructure project that you can put a sticker on.
One of the great joys of being called as a witness to these kind of committees is I find out a huge amount of what's going on from my co-witnesses and other things. So I envy you your position in many ways. But I think really coming back to Dr. Gardner's point, one of the innovations that I think is available to Scotland, especially given the passage of time since the passing of the Act now, is actually to learn from ourselves. I think it's there's no silver bullet of innovation out there to find out, but there must be multiple innovations in around active travel, around infrastructure, around all sorts of things. And I think at the moment that knowledge and learning is probably dispersed across our whole community. So some way of drawing that together to really find out in the last seven years what really worked well, what might we learn from and take forward. So I think that would be a very valuable role, which might be a convening role, which the Parliament and government itself is also very able to exercise.
Okay, thank you for that. Who wants the final word? Ms. Thiam.
No, just worth adding to that. I think that actually this setting of ambitious targets shows great leadership and really is to be, the Scottish Government really has to be congratulated on that, because that sets the bar.
Okay, do members have any final questions? Do the witnesses have any points that they want to place on the record that they haven't done so far? Nope. Great. Okay, in that case, only remains for me to thank the witnesses for their evidence this morning and their patience. That's almost 2 hours, so thank you very much indeed for your time and evidence this morning. That concludes today's committee business. I close this meeting of the committee.